My website is www.crystalkidsradio.com, where you can check out other archives I've posted and you can donate to help. All donations are greatly appreciated. Today, I have a special guest by the name of Graham Phillips. Author Graham Phillips has been described as a historical detective, a modern-day adventurer, and a real-life Indiana Jones. And all, whether you agree with his conclusions or not, Graham's findings are always original and thought-provoking, and a must-read. I recommend his books to everyone. He has an upcoming book called The Lost Tomb of King Arthur, The Search for Camelot, and The Isle of Avalon. I am so excited for Graham because he is a wonderful researcher. We want to hear his opinions because he goes to these places and gets his hands wet. It's totally incredible. He's like the true life Indiana Jones. And today's show is really exciting, and it's going to touch up on so many great topics. So let me not waste any more time and introduce my special guest to the show, Graham Phillips. Hello, Graham. Thank you for coming.
That's absolutely my pleasure. I'm in England at the moment, and it is dark and windy. Probably the same as it is where you are, except it's light there.
Yeah, it's light, of course. I'm so sorry to hear you're not getting good weather. We all want good weather, even though it's November. But I'm just so excited to have you onto the show today. And it's light because it's going to be really great.
Oh, well, thanks very much. I'm looking forward to this.
So let's start on the topics. So could you please give us a brief bio on yourself? Like, you have so many incredible books. So could you please tell us about them and all?
Well, I have written, I think, 17 published books over the years. And they've been on subjects, like historical mysteries, basically. But rather than just investigate boring old history, as some people might put it, I look into myths and legends that could be true, like King Arthur, Robin Hood, and that sort of thing. I also investigate biblical mysteries, such as, was there a real Ark of the Covenant? And if so, what happened to it? Was the Holy Grail real? If so, what happened to that? And I investigate mysteries concerning other figures that are not considered to be so mythological, like William Shakespeare, his secret life. Did he have a secret dark lady, a mistress in the back of his lifestyle? That's the kind of thing I investigate, basically. And I've been doing it for, I don't know, 25 years, I suppose. Wow. And write about it.
That is awesome. 25 years. Congratulations. Oh, this is wonderful to hear. Yes. And you actually have an upcoming book called The Lost Tomb of King Arthur, The Search for Camelot, and The Isle of Avalon. Could you tell us about this, please?
I'll have to keep quite a bit of it secret, because when this comes out in April, probably going to be a world-shattering news event.
Okay.
The reason is that I believe that I have discovered the actual tomb of the man upon whom the legend of King Arthur was based.
Oh, my goodness.
And it's not just me and a couple of sort of friends who've just decided to go out and dig something up. This is a proper archaeological investigation by accredited archaeologists associated with universities and geophysics teams led by leading scientists. And we've located the grave of a man who dates from the period that Arthur is said to have lived, and also is buried in exactly the place that some ancient manuscripts I've discovered at the British Library say that he was buried. That's basically the outline of what this book's going to be about. And it's the book is the whole story of how I started 20 years ago on this search and how I gradually got to find the tomb. Originally, it was the search for a man who was Arthur. Did he really exist? Obviously, the kind of character that's described in myths and legends, fights dragons, rescues damsels in distress, probably didn't exist. I mean, that's the floaty man, as I call him. I was looking for an historical figure that the legend may have been based on. And then after that, when I established a person who I thought was, this guy is the man upon whom the legend was based, I decided to search for where was his base camp, where was his city, hence the search for an historical Camelot, and ultimately the search for his final resting place.
That's so awesome. I can't wait. Where will people be able to purchase this book?
They'll be able to. It's published by an American publisher. Mm-hmm. They're not far from you. They're in Vermont. It's probably about 2,500 miles away. But by my standards, they're based in Vermont. So it'll be published in the States. They also distribute in Canada and throughout the English-speaking world. But basically, you can get it online from Amazon, but it'll be in the shops in the States because the publisher distributes directly to Canada and the USA.
Mm-hmm. Your topics are just incredible. Like, I'm just amazed. Like, this history you don't even learn at school. Like, I went to school and we didn't learn all this. So you are like, you're bringing out a different alternative opinion, and I really appreciate that.
Oh, thank you very much. Your enthusiasm is the sort of thing that I like to get that sort of feedback from people. Usually if I talk to university professors and academics about my work, they say, well, you can't go in search of that. King Arthur didn't really exist. So there's no point in searching for him. And I say, if you take that kind of attitude, I mean, they would have nothing would ever happen. Right. I like to basically try and get people enthusiastic. And the way I write my books isn't written in an academic, stuffy way. I write them as adventures, as kind of as it happened, as I went along, full of anecdotes. I mean, for example, one of the things that I believe that I actually found along my research into the history of King Arthur was an object that may have been the original Holy Grail. Now, in legend, the Holy Grail is said to have been the cup used by Jesus at the Last Supper, mentioned in the Bible, which he said to his disciples, the wine in here will become my blood, and they drank from it, and so forth. According to legend, this cup was used at the crucifixion by one of Jesus' disciples, a guy called Joseph of Arimathea, to collect a few drops of Jesus' blood. At that point, the item became a holy relic. In other words, if you drank from it, it would cure all ills, give you extra life, give you spiritual enlightenment. Now, the legend is that this cup was eventually brought to the British Isles by Joseph of Arimathea because him and his followers were being persecuted by the Romans in Palestine. Mm-hmm. That might sound a long way to go, but there was regular trade routes between the Roman Empire and Britain at that time. And Joseph of Arimathea was said to have been a tin merchant. Mm-hmm. The British Isles had a lot of tin mines, and the Roman Empire needed these. And before the Romans eventually invaded Britain, there was a lot of trade between the Roman Empire and the British Isles. Mm-hmm. Joseph kind of jumped on one of these boats, brought the Holy Grail to Britain, and here it stayed. Eventually, according to stories written in the Middle Ages, it was sought by King Arthur and his knights, and eventually they discover it, give it to Arthur. Arthur drinks from it. He's been ill for a long time. He gets better, manages to reunite the country. And then it's hidden again and never found. Mm-hmm. Now, what I found, that there were two original Grail stories.
Yes.
One of them was the fact that it was the cup used at the Last Supper. The other is that it was a small scent jar used by Jesus's follower, Mary Magdalene, to collect a few drops of Jesus's blood while he was on the cross. Now, that cup, according to legend, remained in Jerusalem until the first Christian Roman empress, a lady called Empress Helena, in the 320s, went there, became a Christian, went there, found this cup, it was claimed, took it back to Rome. It stayed there until Rome was sacked by the barbarians in 410 AD, brought on a convoy of carts to the coast of France, and finally brought to Britain, along with a lot of other holy objects and relics and treasures. And then the cup remained in Britain. Now, that is, again, another of the stories that was written in the Middle Ages, was that King Arthur's knights searched for that cup. So going back 800 years, you've got one set of stories, Arthur's knights searched for the cup of the Last Supper. another set of stories, they search for the cup, the scent jar that belonged to Mary Magdalene. Now, eventually, the cup story overtook and overshadowed completely the scent jar story. So the story we generally know today is it was the cup of the Last Supper, although that certainly wasn't the case in the Middle Ages. Now, one family that claimed to have possessed this actual cup that Mary Magdalene had lived at a place called Whittington Castle in the western part of England. And all the Grail stories call the castle where the Grail is hidden the White Castle in the White Town. Now, Whittington is the Old English for White Town. And the castle there, the ruins of which still remain, is known as the White Castle locally because it's built out of light-coloured limestone. Now, cutting a very long story short, I might explain this later on if you wish, but eventually I trace this cup down to the last living descendants of the people who claimed to have had it in the Middle Ages. So it was my belief that this small little scent jar that once apparently belonged to Mary Magdalene was the cup which started the Grail story. Now, what I did was to take it to the British Museum, and I didn't go up to them and said, is this a Grail or what? I simply took this cup and said, this has been found under unusual circumstances. What is it? They immediately said, that looks like a Roman scent jar. Mm-hmm. Dates from about the first century, but the type of stone it's made of, which was actually green alabaster, which is what the Bible incidentally says Mary Magdalene's cup was made from, they said it probably came from the district of Palestine, what's now Israel, somewhere around Jerusalem. So it comes from the right time and is from the right place to perhaps belong to Mary Magdalene herself. But I'm not saying it really did have anything to do with Jesus, but it certainly, in my opinion, is the cup that started at least a large part of the Grail legend in the Middle Ages. Now, the funny story I was going to tell you, in fact, I have it here. If you'd like to see what it looks like.
Okay.
This. I've borrowed it especially so that you can see it. I've borrowed it so that I can bring it on this show. That, it simply looks like a little egg cup. I mean, you don't drink from it. It was originally a perfume jar.
Oh, really?
And according to the Bible, Mary Magdalene used a perfume jar to go to the to go to Jesus's tomb after the crucifixion in order to anoint his body with precious oils. Now, there would originally have been a top on this, so it wouldn't be running around. And that is the cup, according to the legend, that she used to collect drops of Jesus's blood. Whatever it is, this is 2,000 years old. It comes from the Middle East, and I think it is the cup that started 1,000 quests, if you like. And the reason it's so small is it's because it's a scent jar, not a drinking cup. There may be that cup out there somewhere. I don't know, but this is the one I looked into. Now, the interesting story I was going to tell you about it, and this is the sort of way that I write my books with interesting anecdotes, is when I found this, and we're going back about 20 years now, there was a major media frenzy about it. There was newspapers all over the place writing about it. I was interviewed on the TV, radio, you know what, you name it. So in Italy, obviously a very religious country, it was headline news. The book was translated into Italian. Some clever journalist in Italy started to say, well, hold on a minute, in their newspaper, they said, aren't there other grails already somewhere? And people all over Italy, Spain, South America, other Christian countries, all started coming forward saying, hold on a minute, he hasn't got the grail, we've got it. And there was people in cathedrals in Italy saying they'd got it, and in Spain and everywhere. What they didn't seem to have appreciated with the way that it was written up in the papers is I wasn't talking about the cup of Jesus. I'm talking about the chalice of Mary Magdalene, also known as the chalice of Magdalene, and not this cup. So nobody else claimed to have found that one. So of course they didn't bother reading the book fully. They just read a couple of lines somewhere and wrote about it. So what eventually happened was that somebody, some wise journalist decided, right, okay, we'll let the Vatican sort it out. So they went to the Vatican, asked one of the Pope's advisors, what does the Pope say about this? This guy in England claims to have found the Grail. There's one in this place. There's one somewhere else. There's another one in Mexico. Which is the real one?
Yeah.
I made an announcement. And I thought, people said, you didn't realize the Pope's reading your book. I said, what? And luckily, I mean, there was the Polish Pope at that time, and the book had been published in Polish. I presume he spoke lots of languages, but he could read it in his own language. So they said that His Holiness is reading the book, and at the end of the week, he will give his opinion about whether this is the Grail, and he's also looking into the other claims. And at the end of the week, on the Friday afternoon, he came out onto the balcony where he comes above St. Peter's Square, and he stands there. He leads prayers, and he makes various announcements quite regularly there. And he then says about this little cup here, he says, and the other ones, he said, none of them are the real Grail because we've got it in the Vatican. And everyone went, Since then, of course, everybody started writing to the Vatican telling him that this isn't the cup of Jesus we're talking about. It's the chalice of Magdalene. To which the official press release from the Vatican was, oh, well, yeah, that probably is it then. So I've even got Vatican sort of approval on this cup. So that's the kind of thing I write about anyway. Sorry, I went on a bit then, didn't I?
It's okay. I love what you just talked about. It's just, I love all your topics. You could talk about any topic, and it is so incredible, really. And I also want to just talk about Merlin a little bit, and how he's actually one of the most popular wizards of all. The name Merlin and King Arthur are always linked together. It would seem impossible if the names were never linked. Merlin's the only wizard that seems to surprise us until this very day. I like to talk a little bit about Merlin and who he is. Is he just a myth, or is he really linked to King Arthur?
Well, King Arthur and Merlin both both appear in early documents that were written during the Dark Ages. Say about two. Arthur is said to have lived about 500 AD, 1500 years ago. Mm-hmm. The first documents to really mention him are about 200 years after that.
Right.
And the earliest ones just mention him matter-of-factly, like he was a warrior and he fought the Anglo-Saxons and he did this, he did that. It doesn't have all the stories that are then associated with him later on, which makes him such an unbelievable figure, if you like. At the same time as Arthur is being mentioned in ancient manuscripts, so is Merlin. So we have as much evidence for Merlin from the historical aspect as we do for King Arthur. The only problem is that there seems to have been two separate people called Merlin. Mm-hmm. One of them is recorded as living about 100 years after Arthur. And then there's another one recorded as living at the same time as Arthur. Now, the first question is, well, was Merlin a common name? Well, no, it wasn't. But what it was actually a title.
Okay.
Merlin means in ancient Brythonic, which is the language spoken at that time in Britain, it means the eagle. And some of Merlin's poems that survived in the Middle Ages or were accredited to Merlin are known as the songs or poems of the eagle. The reason being that Celtic people at that time, warriors, mm-hmm. priests, holy men, wizards, anybody of importance, they tended to be given honorary names of animals to in some way to express their prowess. You know, somebody who's cunning as a fox, maybe.
Yeah.
But he was called the eagle. And it seems that people who were particularly highly placed in religious and mystical life during the time Arthur is said to have lived adopted this name, Merlin, the eagle, if they were kind of the head wizard, if you like, and kind of don't think in terms of a wizard at that time as being a sort of somebody like the guy out of Harry Potter or somebody with a pointy hat with stars and moon on it. They were basically druids. They were people who were priests. They were people who were considered magical, because they were able to, well, they knew how to forge metal. They knew how to make the best swords. They developed the ability to have amazing memories, because the Celts really never had they never had a form of writing until the Romans turned up. And when the Romans left, they lost the manufacturing ability to create paper. So there was nothing to write on.
Right.
Most people who recorded history during the Dark Ages had to commit it to memory. And druids, or bards, as they were later known, were taught these amazing memory techniques so that they could remember history, remember how to smelt metal, record battles, and so on and so forth. And some of this memory was in rhyme and song. It's far easier to remember something in rhyme than it is if it doesn't rhyme. It's called mnemonics. And that's what wizards actually were originally. And the head of these bards or druids during the Dark Ages seems to have inherited the name Merlin the Eagle. So that makes it quite difficult to figure out which Merlin we're looking for. But obviously, the Merlin associated with Arthur has to have lived around 500 AD.
Okay.
And just before Arthur's time, there was a writer in the Middle Ages who wrote about Merlin, claiming a man called Geoffrey of Monmouth, which is in Wales. And he claimed to have found a number of references to Merlin and what he did. And he said, and this is clearly a legend, but it was something that he found in some old book somewhere. He was writing in 1130. He wrote that Merlin, when he was a boy, was already developing prophetic powers. He was able to foretell the future. And a king of Britain at the time called Vortigern was trying to build a castle on a hill in Wales. And when the castle kept collapsing, the foundations collapsed, he asked his own advisors, his magicians, if you like, how can I find out why this castle keeps collapsing? And according to the story, they said, you must go and find this boy at this particular place and bring him to you and he'll know. And they went to this particular place, they told him to, and there was this young Merlin, who's 10 years old. The young Merlin then is dragged before the king, Vortigern, and he is asked, apparently you've got prophetic powers. Can you tell me why my castle keeps collapsing?
Mm-hmm.
And he said, the reason is that under the castle there's a pool in which live two dragons, one white and one red, and they fight each other, and that's what's making it happen. So the wizards dug, the magicians that worked for Vortigern and their men, dug down underneath the castle, found this pool, two dragons flew away, and the place was saved. Now, that's clearly a legend associated with Merlin. It's obviously got some symbolic meaning, not going into all that. Now, that is what the earliest references to Merlin in the Middle Ages of any length tell us. That's when he's a boy, the first reference to him, you know, as he comes onto the scene before Arthur is around. It's now, in around about in the 700s, a monk who lived in Britain called Nennius wrote a history book of the British history that was quickly being lost because the Roman Empire had collapsed and Britain was in the Dark Ages. And he wrote a history which still survives in the British Museum in London. And his book is actually called The History of the Britons, Historia Britonium. He wrote this book and he said, tells exactly the same story as Geoffrey of Monmouth in 1130 about this boy being found by Vortigern, who incidentally, Vortigern was an historical king who lived about 480. His name is found recorded on stones and memorials. So we know he was a real king. And Nennius, the monk, says that a boy was brought before the king Vortigern, and he was asked about the castle, why it kept falling down. He revealed this pool with these two dragons, one red, one white, etc., and they flew away and the day was saved. But he doesn't call this person Merlin. He calls him Ambrosius.
Oh, really? Wow.
Now, if there are very few historical records survived from the late 400s, because Britain was in a state of turmoil after the Romans left. They left in 410. Britain was in a state of turmoil and civil war. Very few records survive. But one record written by another monk called Gildas actually wrote in 545 or thereabouts. within living memory of Arthur's time, refers to this man, Ambrosius, whose real name, full name was Ambrosius Aurelius, as a genuine historical figure. His parents had been noble Romans who had lived in Britain.
Mm-hmm.
And Ambrosius is the one about whom the legend had built up that he came to prominence by having these prophetic powers, by revealing these dragons, exactly as Merlin is later said to have done. So consequently, it seems that the original historical man, whose name later became Merlin, which is a title meaning the eagle, his original name was Ambrosius Aurelius, and Ambrosius Aurelius is attested to in Roman writings and records of the time as being an historical leader in Britain who took over and united the Britons around about the year 480 to 490, once our friend Vortigern had died. So it seems that he was a genuine figure. Arthur comes on the scene 10 or 20 years later. By this time, Ambrosius is an old man. So it seems that he then retires from office and makes way for a younger, more powerful person, Arthur, and becomes his advisor. Hence, that's how I believe the story of Merlin began.
Makes perfect sense. Yeah. And is it possible that Arthur's sword could have been a sword from the end of a Roman Empire?
In fact, indeed, I believe so. Mm-hmm. At the end of the Roman Empire, people who ruled various parts of what was left of it in Britain, for example, rather than having a crown as the symbol, which the Anglo-Saxons later had and others after in the Middle Ages, their symbol of office would be a sword, and the hilt would be inscribed with a symbol representing whatever kingdom they ruled over, because Britain was divided into a number of different kingdoms at that time, which had previously been Roman provinces.
Mm-hmm.
And the province of central England, which was known as Viriconium Cornovium, which later became known as the Midlands, which is easier, which is where I live, which Birmingham smack bang in the centre of it. The symbol for this part of the country was a double serpent, two serpents or dragons wrapped around each other, which seems to have been to do with this story of Merlin and two dragons. It's probably because, and this is the reason why two dragons come into it at all, I think, the Kingdom of the Midlands was originally the Roman legion stationed here, had the double twisted around serpents or dragons as their symbol. And so when the Romans left, the person who ruled this part of the country took that as their symbol of office. And this is probably what's implied by Merlin's story or the Ambrosius story, that he became, his parents had been Romans, he became the leader of this part of Britain, and his symbol was the double dragons or the twin serpents. And Excalibur, the oldest known description of Excalibur, is in an old Welsh poem written during the late Dark Ages, and it is described as having two serpents upon its golden hilt, which again suggests it is a symbol of the middle part of England, the symbol of the ruler of this part of the country, which once Ambrosius it had, presumably before him Vortigern had it, and then Arthur inherited this sword. Now, once Arthur died, the country and the whole country fell apart in civil war, and the Anglo-Saxons from Germany invaded the country. And that was the end of it all. So there was no reason to have this sword anymore. Mm-hmm. They didn't want the Anglo-Saxons to get hold of it, and so it was hidden. Now, according to the story of King Arthur, it is thrown into a lake. Now, that might sound crazy, the idea of the sword being thrown into a lake, an arm coming up and grabbing it of the Lady of the Lake, this water nymph, who then grabs the sword and takes it down into the crystal depth. Well, the thing is that that might sound a bit crazy, but the tradition was amongst Celtic warriors before they converted to Christianity, was their prized possessions when they died, in order to get them safe passage to the next life, their prized possessions will be thrown into sacred pools or lakes and sometimes wells. And that tradition still carries on. The Romans actually carried it on, and it's carried on now in the tradition of throwing coins into wishing wells. Mm-hmm. And many dried up lakes have been excavated by archaeologists in Britain and found to have in them swords, shields, and other weapons that have been belonged to famous warriors, renowned warriors, and thrown into these lakes as offerings to a water goddess, mm-hmm. in order to be transported to the other world. So the story of King Arthur's sword as he lies dying, being thrown into a lake, makes perfect sense.
It does.
Arthur lived around 500 AD. His sword wouldn't have been a great big huge broadsword. It would have been a smaller, as you pointed out yourself,
yes.
Roman sword called a spartha, which was a Roman sword about, I don't know, 3 feet long, and was used as a Roman cavalry sword. I actually had a replica made of it. I don't have one of those here with me at the moment. Sorry about that.
No. If
you go to my website, you can actually see a replica of it that I had made.
Could you give us your website, please?
Yes, my website is fairly simple to remember. I am Graham Phillips, so it is grahamphillips.net. I couldn't get .com because there's too many Graham Phillipses in the world. Grahamphillips.net. So just imagine me with a net over my head.
That's a good one.
If you just type in Graham Phillips author, you'll find me. That's how the Druids did it. They remembered things this weird way. People won't forget it's grahamphillips.net because visual memory is how you remember things.
Of course, yes. The way you remember it. Remember it like that and you will never forget it and just put it in. And he has a lot of cool stuff on this site too. So I recommend everyone to go there. So let's talk a little bit about what is Avalon and where is it located?
Ah, it depends which Avalon you mean. Again, it's like being a couple of Merlins. The story of Avalon, just to fill people in on what it is, in the Middle Ages, again, when I say the Middle Ages, I'm talking around about the year 1200.
Right.
Either side of that. Stories were written that when King Arthur died, his body was taken across and buried at the Isle of Avalon. Avalon is mentioned quite a few times in various stories about King Arthur and other heroes in the Middle Ages. And it is supposed to be a mystical island that lies across the Western Sea, i.e. from Britain, somewhere across the Atlantic. Now, some people think that that might be Ireland itself, the Republic of Ireland. Or there's other islands off the coast of Britain, and some of them have been suggested. My research for King Arthur, incidentally, doesn't necessarily suggest that he was actually ever buried on Avalon.
No.
That's another story. Yeah. But the earliest stories of Avalon is that Merlin sailed away to it. Now, the earliest story of Merlin, now remember I've already, I think to my own satisfaction at least, and to other historians, proved that Merlin was based on an historical figure who was once a leader of Britain, then retired, became an advisor. This Merlin, Ambrosius, according to a story that was written about 300 years after those, sometime around 800 AD, it's called The Voyage of Merlin. Mm-hmm. Now, this story talks about Merlin on a voyage to Avalon.
Okay.
He dies in Avalon, he is buried in Avalon, and then some other people make their way back and say, Merlin's buried in Avalon across the Western Sea. But what's interesting, it actually gives a very good description of Merlin's voyage, made presumably by one of the monks who accompanied him. And what it says, firstly, that they set sail and headed north from Scotland.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Which is interesting. So I'm thinking, okay, we're talking about islands up there. Well, the islands of north of Scotland, one of the islands north of Scotland, a group of islands called the Faroe Islands, which now belong to, I think it's Norway. And Faroe Islands actually means Isle of Sheep.
Okay.
The reason being that there was it was a place where somehow, when the first Vikings settled there years later, they found it full of sheep,
yes.
Which meant that somebody must have already gone there and put the sheep there and let them just graze and they kept on breeding. In other words, the Vikings didn't actually discover this. Right. But this is a few, couple of hundred miles north of Britain, north of Scotland. The first island Merlin is said to visit on this voyage to Avalon is called the Isle of Sheep.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So you're thinking, well, wait a minute, that really does suggest that he actually got as far as the Faroe Islands. Interesting, 200 miles off the coast of Britain, fair enough. But he carries on in the story. He sails on until eventually they... Now, this is where people say, oh, it's just a legend. This is just a silly story. They find islands that float in the sea. Massive white islands that crash into each other and fall apart, move apart. And Merlin's boat has to sail between them. What does that sound like? Icebergs. Once you get north of the Faroe Islands, you're heading towards the Arctic Circle. Icebergs sunk the Titanic further south than that.
Right.
These Celtic people who were alive in Dark Age Britain at the time of Arthur wouldn't have known anything about icebergs. Even the Romans didn't know about icebergs. This was written, okay, in 800 AD. They didn't know about them then. The Vikings first started finding out about icebergs in about 900, or maybe a bit earlier than that. But they certainly didn't know about it at the time Merlin was supposed to have been kicking around.
Of course.
People in Europe didn't anyway, not Southern Europe and Northwest Europe.
Yes, right.
But he doesn't stop there. He then continues to on his journey, and then something else comes in, which literary figures have said, oh, this is all nonsense. He ends up at an island that spews forth fire out of mountains. He ends up in a land in which there is water, fountains that blast out of the ground.
Oh,
hot, boiling fountains. What does that sound like?
Sounds like Iceland.
It sounds exactly like Iceland. The geysers of Iceland and the volcanoes.
Of course.
I mean, the Vikings didn't discover that until around about 1000 AD.
Right. Yeah.
They certainly hadn't discovered it in 800, and they certainly hadn't discovered it in 500 when Merlin was supposed to be kicking around. Somebody who wrote this between 500 and 800 AD must have been there. Or known about somebody who'd been there, or got a history of somebody who'd been there. But it's saying that this is Merlin's voyage, and he still hasn't reached Avalon.
Mm-hmm.
He then sails on, and then again something which people are reading the literary figures are saying, oh, that's nonsense. He reaches a place with green seas and green sands.
Greenland.
The reason Greenland is called Greenland is because the first Vikings had found it were absolutely mystified by the kind of rock there and sand, which makes the sea appear green. He can island hop to Greenland. And you're thinking, wow, it's Avalon, Greenland? No. He then ends up talking about they sail on further, and eventually they end up in a place which has a long white beach which goes for miles and miles and miles. And what he describes, and it is exactly the description of what he gives, is the island of Labrador in Canada.
My country.
And eventually he ends up at an island. Now, we don't know exactly where this island is, but he ends up at an island somewhere off the coast of either the southern eastern part of Canada or the northern eastern part of the USA. And there is an island off the coast of Maine called Manana Island. Manana, as I say in America, but Manana, as we would say. Mananan, the name of the island that Merlin eventually reaches when he's on his way to Avalon, is called the island of the sea god Manannan. Now, Manana Island was the name of the island that the Native Americans had already given this place. It's possible that that could be it. That's off the coast of Maine. I believe it's more likely to be somewhere off the coast of somewhere near where you are. Somewhere in Canada. The Vikings eventually got that far south when they traveled there a couple of hundred years later and called it Vinland. The reason it means wineland, land of wine. It was a lot warmer in Canada then in the winter than it is now. It was a lot warmer in Britain. It was a lot warmer, which means it was quite easy for people to, if they had the right kind of boats, to island hop across from Europe to North America, or certainly to Canada, which is what the Vikings did. Then the temperature got a lot colder like it is now, and they couldn't do it anymore.
Right.
So my belief is that Avalon is Canada.
Wow, really? that's cool. And funny, I live here, so it's amazing. I live in Canada, so yeah. Think of it like that. Wow. That's amazing. Wow. I just love your research. It's incredible. It was actually a myth. I wanted to say that about Merlin, actually, that he was involved in the building of Stonehenge, right?
That's the myth.
Right. Yeah.
Stonehenge actually is the Stonehenge itself has been dated by carbon dating. The way that they actually date stones is the stones are put in the ground. Underneath the stones, before they're put in the ground, there's all bits of broken bone and stuff that has been used as picks, like antlers. The Stone Age people that built Stonehenge used antlers as picks. And they used flint axes, and they broke off bits of bone, end up at the bottom of the pits that the stone was put into. You also get bits of broken wood and vegetation at the bottom of these pits to make them solid for when the stone first went in. Mm-hmm. So if you dig up one of these, if you dig down underneath these stones, you can grab organic material, and that can be carbon dated. And the way that radiocarbon dating, as it's called, works is that it can only be used on organic matter, something that once lived, whether it's animal or vegetable, wood, bone, something like that. And while we're alive, we take in a substance from the atmosphere and from what we eat called carbon 14. It's a kind of, it's an isotope of carbon. Don't worry too much about that, what that is. But it's got a radioactive element to it. Not enough to hurt anyone. It's very low, but it can be detected by scientific methods. Once the thing dies, the tree or the person or the animal, the bone or the wood or whatever gradually loses this radioactivity. It's called half-life, until after about 50,000 years, it's pretty much gone altogether. Mm-hmm. So by getting a bit of wood that's been found from under this stone or a bit of bone, and actually subjecting it to scientific techniques, they can discover how much carbon 14 still remains, and therefore get an accurate scientific dating to within about 50 years either way. And this has been done repeatedly at Stonehenge under various stones, and it's dated to the main big stones to about 3,500 years ago. Now, Merlin is 1,500 years ago. So I can say absolutely for a fact that Stonehenge was not built by Merlin.
Okay.
But whether he actually ever used it, it's a different matter. The Druids, or the Bards, as they were called during the Dark Ages, certainly used the stone circles that survived in Britain. They thought that they'd been built centuries before by the gods for ceremonies. And some legends say that Merlin is buried near Stonehenge. So certainly Stonehenge could have been used by Merlin for whatever he did, for his various magical exploits, if you like, or the way he used to convince people he was magic. Interestingly enough, there could be associations where he may have used it as some sort of religious center, because the nearest little town to Stonehenge is called Amesbury, which is named after Ambrosius. It was originally Ambrosius Town, Ambrose Town, Amesbury. So it's named after the man who I believe was the real historical Merlin. And that's only a couple of miles from Stonehenge. So he could very well have had something to do with the play.
Could be possible. Wow. Mm-hmm. Well, during the 1500s, John Dee opens up a Pandora box by leaning above the occult. He wrote many books. John Dee writes with a philosopher's stone and esoteric symbolism. Merlin goes through a transformation through this period. Merlin begins to shape up as we see him today in modern movies. Could you please tell us about this?
About how Merlin becomes the wizard we know today.
Yes, please.
It all really comes down to the period of the Elizabethan period, a period of Shakespeare and the theatre. What happened is that we all know Shakespeare. We're forced to learn him at school.
Right.
Even people in the non-English speaking world. I'd hate to learn Shakespeare in Japanese, but then again, they obviously have to do it. We don't have to learn Japanese poets, thank goodness. That's difficult. I mean, I've spent quite a bit of time learning Japanese because I'm doing a new project over there. So thank goodness that we don't have to learn all their poems, but they have to learn our Shakespeare. Anyway, so Shakespeare is the one everybody knows. But the whole craze, if you like, of playwriting started in the Elizabethan period, i.e. the late 1500s in Britain, the Tudor period. And there were many playwrights, as well as William Shakespeare. Before the first purpose-built theatres were created in London, what happened was that a group of players, actors, would travel from stately home to stately home around the country, entertaining the aristocracy. And it was a way to make a good living.
Mm-hmm.
What could they do? No internet, no TV, no mobile phones, no nothing. So when you had these actors turn up and put up a performance, it was good stuff. So it suddenly became very popular in Britain in the Tudor period for this to happen. And there were many people writing plays and performing them and joining troops of actors. Shakespeare was just one that eventually became really big and had a purpose-built theatre, the Globe in London. But there were lots of these travelling actors, and there was big demand for people to write plays.
Right.
So, first of all, people all pick on historical figures we all know and love. Well, you've only got so many kings you can write about. So they then start to pick on ancient figures that they knew, Julius Caesar and Cleopatra, like Shakespeare did. But then they began to pick upon mythological people or people they knew very little about that seemed to be sort of legendary figures in Britain. Robin Hood, King Arthur, and Merlin. And one particular playwright called Ben Jonson, who was almost as big as Shakespeare in his day, he wrote a poem that then he turned later into a play about Merlin.
Oh.
Merlin was a wizard, and how Merlin had great powers, and how Merlin could summon dragons. Some of this stuff he took from the legends that already existed. Some of it he just made up. It was a play.
Right.
And so the Merlin we know and love today was basically created by this Ben Jonson. I mean, it's not totally him. There was other people before that that started to write about the full Merlin story, but he kind of put it all together in a now lost play, unfortunately. Only a couple of pages of it still survive.
Mm.
And one of the people who actually helped Ben Jonson edit this was William Shakespeare. And it is believed that the Merlin play, which originally had an extremely long title, which was The Story of Merlin and His Rise to Fame in the Court of King Arthur in Camelot, along with the Knights of the Round Table, and fell in love with the Lady of the Lake, whose name is Nimue. I think I pronounced that right. With the name shortened to Merlin. And it is believed that Shakespeare had a part to play in this. I mean, Shakespeare might have had some part to play in the Merlin story. In 1612, I believe it was, after Queen Elizabeth died, the king on the English throne was James the First, after whom Jamestown in the USA is named. There's probably a Jamestown in Canada too, I should imagine, somewhere. A lot of places are named after that king because he was the one responsible for setting up some of the first colonies in Canada and America, the British colonies. James the First, mm-hmm. when his daughter Elizabeth got married, I think it's 1612, I might be out by a couple of years, I can't just remember it all off the top of my head at the moment. When he got married, what he wanted to do was to perform this play, Merlin, at the wedding of his daughter. So he actually had a stage made. They literally had to make stages because he wasn't going to have it at the ordinary Globe Theatre or something, designed by Britain's top architect, Inigo Jones. And he got Ben Jonson and dragged Shakespeare along too to perform this Merlin poem for him, for his daughter. Basically, Shakespeare wanted to put on The Tempest instead. So they had to sit through both Merlin and The Tempest. Shakespeare and Ben Jonson fell out, and the legend is they never spoke again until Ben Jonson wrote an obituary when Shakespeare died. And so the story of Merlin we now know and love and watch on that kids' programme that you probably get in Canada, it's on every week in England, is all based on something that Shakespeare and his mate Ben Jonson did for Queen Elizabeth and eventually put it all back together again for the daughter of James the First of England in around about 1612. There you go. Is that what you wanted to know?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, you answered that question wonderfully. Yeah, right. And I'd like to also talk about more about Shakespeare and like about if he wrote plays or not. There's a lot of controversy over that. So I want to talk about that. So actually, there's not even any evidence that Shakespeare was highly educated. Like, yeah, he had a vocabulary of 30,000 words. And, you know, to write his plays, this type of plays, you would have to know geography very well of Europe. But you had to know history, and you had to know Latin and Greek, right? Right?
That's absolutely right.
Right. So, yeah, and he was even inventing his own language. Back in those days, they didn't have libraries like today. It's not like you're able to go get a library card and go and check out a book, right? Or go online. They didn't have technology like today. Like, you could search it up and mention that. Oh, where is this? Where is that? Or what's the history of this, right? And technology has really brought in a lot of different things. But back then, they didn't have that knowledge. So... yeah, so if he wasn't highly educated, how would he have been able to write the plays?
Well, this is one of the mysteries I was looking into in a book that I did. Again, it's going back, so you'll have to excuse me if I forget some of the facts. This was written about 20 years ago.
I understand.
Conspiracy. Now, in those days, 20 years ago, the word conspiracy wasn't a bad word. Now they'll say to me, oh, you're just a conspiracy theorist. Yeah, but back then the word conspiracy wasn't bad. It just simply means that there has been a conspiracy in Elizabethan England to cover up something to do with Shakespeare. I'm not going out saying that sort of, you know, that there's that Martians are invading or that the world's going to blow up in a few years when it's hit by an asteroid or any other kind of mad conspiracy. This is simply, so the book might sound like it's a bit nuts, but it's a straightforward historical investigation. Written in the kind of way that I normally write, you know, explaining things that are going on. So there'd been a lot of talk. You're absolutely right. William Shakespeare is said to have lived in Stratford-upon-Avon, in this not far from Birmingham, where I live, in the centre of England, in Warwickshire, or Warwickshire, as my American and Canadian friends call it. And Stratford-upon-Avon, there's a tomb there in the church which says, to the effect of it, William Shakespeare died in 1616, April 23rd, And above where the grave is, there's a bust of him on the wall, about, I don't know, four or five feet tall, about 3 feet wide. And it's from about there, sort of like his chest upwards, and he's resting his arms on a cushion, and he's got a parchment underneath his one hand, and he's got a feather pen in the other, and it's the balding, pointy bearded man we all know and love, William Shakespeare. So everyone says, well, yeah, this is him. So, okay, let us first look into this William Shakespeare. The first thing is that the William Shakespeare that's buried there never seems to have had an education. Mm-hmm. The records of all the surviving writing that this William Shakespeare did in Stratford-upon-Avon show that he went to a kind of equivalent to an elementary school and then didn't go on to university. Instead, he went into business. His father was a glover, made quite a lot of money. Shakespeare used some of this money to start a business growing malt and barley, getting malt and barley for the brewery industry. He basically was a beer maker, if you like.
Oh, really?
There's all the records that he bought large tracts of land to grow the grain to make the beer. There's lots of records that he bought property and then rented it out, so he was a landlord, and he's spending all his time. That's how all the evidence shows he's making his money. He marries a woman called Anne Hathaway, he has a number of children, and then in the 1590s, he buys the second biggest house in the town with the money he's made from all this brewery stuff. There's even a Flowers Brewery where you come to Britain, you go into pubs, and it's got Shakespeare's head on it, and it's his direct descendants that actually still own that brewery making beer, and you see his face on it. But that's another story. So Shakespeare's, all the records show he made his money in malt and grain for the brewery industry. Now, what's interesting is Bill said, yeah, but he must have been the same playwright, because when you go to the church, you see the bust of him, his statue, it's got the man with his pen and paper writing. That's a fake. Now, something I discovered that no one seemed to have had taken much notice of is that it is recorded that that particular bust was put above the grave of William Shakespeare only in 1744. By some local guy who decided that Shakespeare, the playwright, should have a fitting memorial.
Yeah.
A number of drawings that survive in Stratford Library of the original period from the 1600s survive of what the original bust looked like. It shows a balding man with a pointy beard, and his hands are on a sack. Now, the tradition was in those times is that somebody of importance or had a lot of money, the statue would show them doing what they did to make their living.
Why?
Shakespeare's case is clearly the original bust shows him as being a dealer in bagged commodities. In other words, malt and grain, just like all the records say that he made his money. Mm-hmm. So this obviously started people thinking, hold on a minute, there's no evidence that this Shakespeare was educated, that he, to a university level, he was a rich man, but he was a merchant. He never associated with the kinds of people or travelled around like an aristocrat to all the places in Europe that he wrote about. As you rightly said, there's no evidence he was ever taught Latin except for at a very elementary level, but he obviously spoke it very well, as he wouldn't have known all the Julius Caesar stuff and things like that.
Correct.
So the people start to think, well, the William Shakespeare of Stratford could not have written the plays. It must have been somebody else. And various theories over the years have built up. One of them is that a film was made of it. I can't remember what the name was now. It came out a few years ago, saying that William Shakespeare was really the front for the Earl of Oxford, who was an educated man who could have written the plays. But the reason he didn't want to write the plays is because it was not considered fitting for an aristocrat to get involved in the theatre. It was considered something for lower class people. so he couldn't do it himself, so he picked William Shakespeare as a front man. There are a number of other candidates for people who might have written the plays and put Shakespeare's name on it. But the big question in my mind is, if you're going to write plays and you're a very famous person and rich aristocrat and you want the plays to be published for whatever reason and you want somebody else to front them, why pick somebody who's a grain merchant?
Right, that's my question too.
It's just nuts. You'd pick somebody like Ben Jonson, the guy I mentioned before, or a host of other. There's loads of proper playwrights he could have picked. Why pick this guy with William Shakespeare? So I thought, okay, where does this Shakespeare, why do we even think he's associated with the plays in the first place? Because one thing, apart from a few, I mentioned a manuscript of which he helped to write with Ben Jonson about Merlin. The original doesn't survive. We haven't got any of his handwriting. It's just copies that were later made. None of his original, not one single one of Shakespeare's manuscripts or poems actually survives with his own handwriting on it. The only handwriting we actually have of William Shakespeare is from the guy who comes from Stratford, and it's just signatures on land deeds or property rented and stuff like that. And it's basically, each signature seems to be slightly different, which suggests that he is a man who's not used to writing. Most people didn't have to write if they were merchants. They'd get somebody else to pay to do it for them. They would just dictate. It doesn't even seem, the man might not have even been able to write very well at all, as you mentioned.
Right.
Why do we even think he wrote these plays? Well, when Shakespeare died in 1616, a few years later, Ben Jonson, who I mentioned earlier, who didn't really like Shakespeare very much, published all of Shakespeare's works that we now know, or most of them, in a book called The First Folio, with a picture of Shakespeare's head on it. Now, the Shakespeare's head is this baldy man with a pointy beard, and it's just a lithograph or a woodcut or something, a drawing of his head. Which is the same kind of head that we see on this bust in the church now, which was copied from this original portfolio. It doesn't look very complimentary. He's got two left eyes for a start. And it says these are the complete works of William Shakespeare. And then Ben Jonson writes a bit at the beginning saying, Shakespeare's plays, we want to make sure that they're good plays. We want to make sure that they're not lost. And here's the people who acted in them and blah, 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 blah. And here they are. And what he actually says, he calls Shakespeare at one point, he refers to his Stratford monument. He also refers to Shakespeare as a sweet swan of Avon. But considering the river, there are about three River Avons in Britain, and going back then, Avon simply means river. It's Welsh, Afon for river. There were about, that I've discovered anyway, 30 rivers in this country that were known as the Avon, including the Upper Thames. So one of the river is all simply Ben Jonson is saying. Second, who's half Welsh, by the way, so he would probably use a lot of Welsh words anyway. So forgetting the fact that he is so the Stratford and the Avon things mentioned, saying, oh, Stratford and Avon, but he does say Stratford monument. So we know he's got a monument in Stratford to him. And he is the Swan of Avon. Well, the swan is just about another word for basically saying he's a poet, and a good poet of the river. Now, what that means, who knows? It may not be to do. But the people who believe he comes from Stratford said, yes, that's the man, that's where he came from. After that, people didn't really care very much where he came from, because after James I, his son Charles I came onto the English throne. Then there was a civil war, when the Puritans under Oliver Cromwell took over, and they stopped theatre. They said it was bad. We weren't even allowed to dance in Britain in the mid-1600s. It's where mince pies come from. People weren't allowed to make cakes at Christmas or anything sweet to celebrate it, because God wouldn't like it, according to the Puritans. And so people had to pretend that pies with mince meat in them were actually the things they were eating, just ordinary mince meat pies. which is why we've got mince pies at Christmas now. But anyway, that's another story. So theatre was out.
Yes.
And it wasn't until the period called the Restoration, where Charles II came to the throne after Cromwell died, that theatre got going again, and in a big way. And there's a lot of theatres were built in London and around Britain and elsewhere in Europe at the beginning, in the late 1600s. It's called the Restoration period, and many plays were written. People liked Shakespeare's plays, and they found these plays. Oh, wow, these were performed in Elizabethan times. Let's start performing them. And suddenly, everyone wanted to know, well, who wrote these plays? And they found this first folio. Well, who is this Shakespeare? Where's he come from? And when they saw the Stratford reference, they went to Stratford-on-Avon and found there in the church, there was a plaque on the floor saying, here lies William Shakespeare, died 1616. Oh, makes sense. This is the guy. Yeah. The bust on the wall might show a man originally with his hands on a malt sack or whatever it is, but, well, okay, yeah, he made money in grain and then went off to write plays in London. Okay, so that's where the sort of link comes in. But the problem is that the name William Shakespeare was relatively common then. The Shakespeare family, I have found reference to, I think 29 William Shakespeares that were alive at the same time as he was, quite a few of them living in London.
Really?
Shakespeare, the name went out of fashion because it actually became a name of... how do I say this without sounding rude? It became known as a rude word for a whole host of reasons, and people stopped using it. So people whose name was Shakespeare changed their name to something else. So, but Shakespeare was quite a common name. William is a very common name, still is, was then. Now, this isn't saying this is proof that William Shakespeare didn't come from Stratford-upon-Avon, but let us just see what we know about Shakespeare, the playwright in London. There is a William Shakespeare, a playwright, recorded as being working at the Globe Theatre in the early 1600s. There are the people he's acting with in plays. He's a writer of, he's a writer of plays, and he acts in plays, and he directs them in the theatre in London. He lives, there's actual records about where he lived. He lived in a little sort of small apartment in a dirty part of London called Bishopsgate, which is very close to where the theatres were then. And he's constantly, all the records about him, we don't know very much at all, other than people are constantly after him for money. He's, the authorities on one occasion are looking for him for a debt of 5 shillings. That would be, I don't know, it'd be like looking for him for £50 now or something. Or $50 or whatever. It's not a lot of money. So this man was pretty poor. He never managed to pay these debts. The authorities are still looking for him a few months later for the same amount until eventually somebody pays it on his behalf. He's constantly being thrown out of different rented apartments, rented accommodation in slum areas for not being able to afford to pay the rent. Playwrights at that time got a measly amount of money, and acting wasn't very well paid at all. There's various accounts of him being drunk and disorderly. There's accounts of him actually threatening the life of one of his fellow actors. This is the real Shakespeare who was working in the theatre, a rough kind of drinking sort of always running out on debts kind of, just like most great artists and struggling poets. Your Van Goghs of this world, people who do great works of art are very often spent their time broke and are not recognised until they're dead. They're very often either drug addicts or drunks. I mean, look at Lord Byron and all that lot, the romantic poets. They're all high as a kite all the time. I mean, so this kind of fits with the kind of person you'd imagine Shakespeare to be. It fits with the other playwrights at the time.
Yes.
So there is a William Shakespeare, and he is writing plays. But the week, the very week, that they are seeking him for 5 shillings that he owes for payment on this fallen down old flat that he can't afford to pay in London. This William Shakespeare in Stratford-upon-Avon, the very same week in 1593, in October, is actually buying the second biggest house in the town.
Oh boy.
And also lends another person in the area £50, which would be like lending them thousands now. So one is being sought for $50, say, and can't afford to pay the rent on a falling down old flea pit in London. Mm-hmm. At the very same time, he's renting out property in Stratford, buying the second biggest house in the town, and lending somebody thousands of dollars, if you like.
Oh boy.
And that's just one example. Over and over again, we find that the poor struggling writer in Stratford-upon-Avon is running away from all authorities, where the Stratford, where the one in London is running away from the authorities and can't afford to pay debts and he's getting into drunken brawls, where the man in Stratford is described as a gentleman who goes to church with his family, well-respected, and has loads of money. Well, there's got to be two William Shakespeares.
Double.
So in other words, the idea that the reason why Shakespeare of Stratford, he's not the front man for somebody else writing the plays, he's just being confused with him because he has the same name, and the name Stratford appears in the first folio of his works. Now, why does Stratford appear there? Because just a couple of miles away from where Shakespeare is living in Bishopsgate in London and where the theatres are, there's a borough of East London, which was then a village, called Stratford. It's where the Olympic Games were held. It's where the Olympic Village was.
Oh.
Known throughout the world a couple of years ago, the Olympics took place in Stratford, the area of East London. That is, I believe, the Stratford that Shakespeare came from. Unfortunately, all records of anybody who lived there and any monument where his Stratford monument might have been were bombed flat in the war by German bombers. And so I cannot get the final evidence to prove that William Shakespeare really came from Stratford in East London and has got nothing to do with the guy in Stratford-upon-Avon. But for a long time, I was actually banned from going into any of the libraries in Stratford-upon-Avon because they said, heretic, heretic, get rid of the man, get rid of him. They even, in the Stratford, Birthplace Trust, which has all his documents and owns the place where he was supposed to be born and all that, you know, these Shakespeare's, of the Stratford-upon-Avon Shakespeare, they actually had a photograph of me put under the sort of counter of the person at the desk. If they saw me coming in, they'd kick me out. I had to go in disguise with a beard and dark glasses to get in. And these are the stories I tell in my book. But anyway, that's where it's kind of left at the moment. And next year, is the 400th year anniversary from when the Shakespeare in Stratford-upon-Avon died on the 23rd of April. Next year. And I've decided I'm going to go into Stratford-upon-Avon and cause one heck of a fuss and film myself doing it and shove it on my website.
I can't wait to see it. Yeah, I can't wait. And maybe I could have you onto my show again to talk about that.
Oh, yeah, cool. That would be brilliant. Yeah.
Yeah, that would be brilliant. Yeah, so, yeah, and Shakespeare, like you said before, he does seem like he is living a double life. Seriously, he does. And also, there was one thing that Shakespeare did that was very inconsiderate. He left his wife his second best bed. I couldn't believe it when I did that. It's like, oh my, what is he doing here?
It's absolutely right. I've seen the will, the actual thing itself, you know, when I went in disguise to get in there and have a look at it. This is the rich one from Stratford-upon-Avon. He leaves money to his daughter and his son-in-law and people. And all he leaves his wife specifically is his second best bed. Now, the people who want to promote Shakespeare, this nice, lovely, happy family man, basically say, oh yes, but she'd have on the law at that time, she'd have inherited most of what he had anyway. Well, fine, then why mention her at all? To actually say I'm going to give you my second best bed is an insult by anybody's standards. Who was the first one for?
I know, it's just so offensive.
If somebody left me a second best bed, well, I wouldn't be very happy.
Oh, I wouldn't either. I understand, yeah. But is it possible that Shakespeare was homosexual?
Which one?
I don't know. Take it back.
Okay, we'll talk about the playwright. The playwright who lived in London, rather than the man of another name, because, I mean, the Shakespeare, the playwright, the reason why people think that he may have been gay is the fact that he wrote a series of sonnets, poems, to the Earl of, well, basically addressing the Earl of Southampton, who was renowned open homosexual. He made no, there was no, there wasn't the kind of fuss about it really in Victorian times that there was later, like in Victorian, sorry, there wasn't this kind of fuss about it in Elizabethan times that there might have been in Victorian times, especially if you were rich and very powerful. Now, the Earl of Southampton was a patron of the arts, and basically he was the only way that a playwright could really make money isn't out of what he got paid for his plays. It was if somebody sponsored him, was his patron. And the Earl of Southampton was his patron. And so the fact that he wrote a series of poems describing him as this wonderful, lovely, beautiful man was probably to get money out of him, not necessarily that he expected to actually have any association with him in a sexual way. Well, he certainly wouldn't. There was no way that someone like the Earl of Southampton, one of the richest and wealthiest aristocrats in the country, would have anything to do with some smelly individual like William Shakespeare. So, but it, the fact that he wrote these poems to him, which seemed to be homosexual, is probably just the way that Shakespeare was trying to get money. There's no evidence of his sexual orientation at all. There's, because that the whole of the records of Stratford and East London have been destroyed in the bombing and the war, or most of them, certainly of that time, there's no way of knowing if he had a wife, if he had a kids or anything.
Right.
The one in Stratford-upon-Avon seems to have just led a straightforward, boring life and gone to church. I doubt if he would have been homosexual at all. If the first best bed was probably for another woman,
right.
It was for a man.
Right. But, well, whatever he was, right? But he was living a double life, right? So we have to see that as...
Well, he's either living a double life, there's either two of him, or someone's using him as a front man.
But he was living, there's two different people involved here, so it's kind of...
Unless he was some kind of schizoid, but I have suggested in my original book, Shakespeare Conspiracy, I suggest that he might have been working as some kind of government spy.
Could have been.
And so, but I mean, it's because there was a lot, the playwrights at the time were being used by the English Secret Service. The Secret Service in England was originally founded by the Protestant regime to spy on Catholics to make sure they weren't trying to blow up the Houses of Parliament like Guy Fawkes tried to do in 1605. They basically wanted to see if there was going to be Catholic conspiracies. At that time, the Queen Elizabeth and her ministers didn't know who was loyal Catholics, who was Protestants, who was planning rebellions. So they wanted people to go and spy on them. And one lot of people that travelled around all over the country to the different stately homes and stayed with all these various lords were these travelling players, these playwrights. And so the Secret Service, as it was originally called, which was founded by the kind of chief minister of Queen Elizabeth I, whose name was Francis Walsingham, he basically paid a number of playwrights. For example, one called Christopher Marlowe, Ben Jonson's another, the guy I mentioned before, to actually inform him about the talk he heard when everyone got drunk after the plays were over. Do you think they're Catholic sympathisers? Do you think they're plotting against the Queen? And Shakespeare could have been one of these.
Mm-hmm.
There's no actual proof that he was, in which case he might have wanted to sort of lead some double life. But I can't really make sense of, okay, being a massively rich guy in Stratford and the Midlands and living like a poor man, and what's the point? That doesn't even seem to fit, like, you know. But what I found funny is when I'd suggested that Shakespeare could be a spy, this is what all the media picked up on. And my favourite of all the quotes on one of the British newspapers was William Shakespeare licensed to quill. But there you go.
Yes, and actually, I have a question. Was Shakespeare involved in the occult?
In what, sorry?
In the occult. Occult.
No, not necessarily. There's no evidence that... And he could have been at the time. Mm-hmm. In 1604... Right, okay, how do I start this? Right. In the year 1604, mm-hmm. a new star appeared in the skies. Now, that, you think, how can a new star appear? It was what we would today call a supernova. It's basically a star which explodes. And when stars, and they're only, not all stars explode, and they have to be very big ones before they go supernova, and there's only one in a galaxy about every 100 years, so I wouldn't worry about our sun doing that. But when a star goes supernova, it blows up with such brightness that for a few months, it outshines all the other stars in its native galaxy. In fact, that's how we see supernovae with telescopes these days on Earth that are taking place in other galaxies. And you can see a bright spot, brighter than any other star. Now, we haven't had one in this country since 1604. Sorry, in this galaxy since 1604.
Okay.
And it appeared in the constellation of Cygnus the Swan. And so, as far as everybody, you could act, it was bright enough in the sky that you could read by it at night. So you'd suddenly get this extremely bright star. No one had ever known this happened before. Stars didn't just appear. The last time anybody knew it had happened, as far as most people were concerned, was what the Bible tells us when a new star appeared in Bethlehem to guide the wise men to Jesus. So they thought, wow, astrologers thought this must mean that some great important person has been born. Now, loads of other people had other ideas about that it meant a new age was beginning. So a society was started off in France and in Britain and Holland called the Rosicrucians. It's because their symbol was a rose with a cross with a rose in the middle of it, rose and cross, Rosicrucians. And this, they started off and basically decided that event, because this new star appeared, they decided that they ought to start really studying astrology and other forms of magic and occult. And so the modern idea of the occult, of pentagrams and all this kind of stuff, all started about then. It doesn't go way back to ancient times. It doesn't go back to biblical times or even the Middle Ages. It was pretty much invented around 1604. And this star got so many people interested, it became a real big fad. Now, a lot of people got involved in this, including Walter Raleigh, the man who set up the colony of Virginia in America and brought back the potato to England and made smoking popular. Now, Sir Walter Raleigh was married to Shakespeare's cousin. Mm. Now, Walter Raleigh started his own Rosicrucian group called the School of Night, of which he was eventually accused of heresy and thrown into prison by James I. But many people were part of this group that started studying magic and the occult. And because one of these people was Sir Walter Raleigh, who was Shakespeare's cousin-in-law, it's possible that Shakespeare may have had some involvement in the occult. But later on, this Rosicrucian group, as the 1600s went on, had to sort of go underground and become inconspicuous during the Puritan era. But after that, at the end of the 1600s, it broke into two parts. Right. One became the Freemasons, and the other became scientists like Isaac Newton. Suddenly, by studying all this weird occult stuff, they began to start thinking about scientific method. And that's how Newton eventually, it was as much an alchemist as anything else, eventually worked out the theories of gravity. And another lot of these people became Freemasons. So if it wasn't for this star suddenly appearing, we may not have modern science, and we may not even have Freemasons. Interesting.
Interesting.
And Shakespeare could have been right there at the beginning of it all.
Wow. Amazing stuff. Well, I like CCN. Please Now we're going to be talking about the Search for the Lost Ark. So, CCN, could you please be so kind to play a clip from Search for the Lost Ark? I really would appreciate that. Thank you.
And we found ourselves entering a tiny little village by the name of Chapel Green. The village was so named, we discovered, because a chapel, a medieval chapel, had once stood there. The chapel still survived as a ruin in the 19th century, but all that remained now was an old holy well. In fact, even that had been replaced by a Victorian drinking fountain. And it was this that convinced us we were in the right place, because it was a red brick arch, and that's exactly what we were looking for. And it had been there in Jacob Cove Jones's day. In his time, we discovered the remains of the chapel had still stood beside the well, but in the 1950s, these had been removed to make way for the road. So, had the ark been dug up? We discovered from a local farmer that the stones that were the remains of the old chapel, when they were taken away in the 1950s, they were used to dam a stream in a nearby wood. In the bank of the stream, Jody discovered something quite remarkable. A stone tablet about 1 foot square, about 2 inches thick, and carved with a mysterious inscription. Forensic examination showed the stone to be around 3,500 years old, and the sandstone from which it was made came from the Sinai wilderness in southern Israel, which is exactly the place that the Ark of the Covenant was said to have been made to contain the Ten Commandment tablets. Could this be one of them? The search for the Ark continued.
Thank you, Biggie. That was good, wasn't it? It must have been exciting to discover the stone tablet with inscription on it. Could you please tell us more about this?
Well, this all began with the investigation into what the Ark of the Covenant was. Now, in the Bible, there are two arks. There's the ark that Noah made, which all the animals went into two by two. This is not that. This is the Ark of the Covenant is a golden chest, which was made by the ancient Israelites, according to the Bible, to contain the Ten Commandment tablets. And according to the Bible, Moses went up Mount Sinai, God spoke to him, inscribed these two tablets with the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not kill, etc., etc. And Moses brought them down from Mount Sinai, broke them actually, then went out, had to go back and get some other ones, but that's another story. And when he eventually, the Ark of the Covenant, this big gold chest, which is supposed to be about 3 or 4 feet long and about 2 or 3 feet wide and 3 or 4 feet high, with two angels carved on the lid and some poles for carrying it, this Ark of the Covenant was made out of gold overlaid on wood, and it was made to contain the Ten Commandments, because they were supposed to have been written by the hand of God himself. Now, for 40 years after they escaped from Egypt, the Israelites are said to have wandered in the desert to the east of Egypt. And they carried the ark with them. Now, it looks sort of like this. This is a little busted up model of what it sort of looked like.
Hey, that's cool.
With a couple of kind of angels on with wings and...
Wow.
But it was bigger than that.
Of course.
This is just for keeping stuff in. But I mean, it's got a top that comes off it, and it had two handles for carrying it. But it'd be a big thing, you know, 4 feet long or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So that is basically what the Ark of the Covenant was supposed to be. Now, this was used to carry the Ten Commandments around. It was also used as a sort of radio for talking to God, as Indiana Jones describes it. In the Bible, if you read the Old Testament, you will always say, hear them. You'll hear the words, something like, and God spoke unto the Israel, saying, well, who's doing the speaking? Are they hearing his voice booming in the air? No, it's the priests or the prophets who, when they are close to the ark, and put their hands on the ark, and God inspires them to speak. That's what's going on. So this is what the important the ark is. It's a kind of mobile temple. When they eventually, years later, settled in Jerusalem and founded Israel, about 1000 BC, 3000 years ago, they built a temple, the Temple of Solomon. King Solomon of the King of Israel built a temple in which to keep this ark and the Ten Commandment tablets. It was the ancient Israelites' most holy item. Now, it was not only kind of a radio for talking to God, so to speak. It was also said when the Israelite armies carried the ark before their soldiers, beams of light shot out of it and kind of blasted people like kind of lasers. Now, a lot of this is probably mythology, but it certainly was a very holy item that seems to have been an historical, physical thing that did exist and was kept in the temple in Jerusalem. Now, in 600 BC or thereabouts, the Babylonians from what's now Iraq invaded Israel and destroyed the temple. But according to the Bible, according to a book in the Bible, which actually is only in the Catholic Bible and not now in the Protestant one, called the Second Book of Maccabees, it was always in the original Bible. But for some reason, the Protestants took it out. I have to look into that. Don't know why. But this mentions that one of the high priests of Jerusalem temple took the Ark of the Covenant out. Apparently he had a vision, God told him, but he probably had intelligence that the Babylonians would come in, got the Ark out of the temple and managed to hide it somewhere in the Sinai wilderness and the desert, the Negev desert, south of Israel. Now, nobody knew where this was. It was hidden in a cave, and that was the end of it. The Ark of the Covenant vanished, gone, finished. And that's the last we hear of it. Various legends have surfaced, but I managed to discover that in the 1200s, a group of knights called the Knights Templars, who were crusaders fighting against the Muslims in the Holy Land, Christians were fighting Muslims over the possession of Jerusalem for many, many years. And in the 1200s, not south of Jerusalem, in the what's now Jordan, in a city called Petra, the Knights Templars, it was like a ruined city dating from pre-Roman times, the Knights Templars who were guarding that area claimed to have found the Ark of the Covenant in a cave there. Mm-hmm. Now, I did a lot of research that suggested that really could have been where the Ark was hidden. So I was interested. I mean, and I thought, I'll look into who were these Knights Templars who claimed to have found this Ark. So I managed to discover, I mean, this took quite a bit of time because when I was doing this research, I didn't have the internet. So I had to look through all sorts of books. Eventually found out that the ones where from there came from a place named after them called Temple Hardwick, which is very close to Stratford-upon-Avon, where one of the Shakespeares lived in the centre of England. It all seems to come back to this part of England for some reason. I travel around the world and it ends up, I find something just around the corner. It's weird. Anyway, so these Knights Templars brought back, according to the records that still survive in that part of England, in Warwickshire, in Temple Hardwick, they built a temple, a chapel, specifically to house holy items they'd brought back from the Holy Land. Now, this wasn't unusual for knights who came back from the Holy Land. They could pick up anything in Eastern bazaars and say it belonged to Jesus or belonged to Mary, the Mother of God, or Moses, or King David, or anything. So a lot of people didn't take too seriously the fact that they claimed to have found a big golden box, which is the Ark of the Covenant. Mm-hmm. But my research suggested that where they claimed to have found it could very well have been where it ended up. So I thought, okay, what did they do with this thing? Because the Knights Templars were eventually dissolved. They were branded as heretics by the Pope in 1307. And in Britain, they lasted a lot bit longer, but eventually the king managed to sort of round them all up and strip them of their lands because he wanted the money himself. And whatever Templars were left were killed off by the Black Death pretty much in the mid-1300s. What the Templars, I thought, so what happened to this object that they believed was the Ark? Did it just get torn apart, melted down, stolen? Well, eventually I found out that they, about the year that the Black Death started, they built this chapel, as I said.
Okay.
They built a second chapel because the first one was crumbling. And in this chapel, they left a series of paintings behind the wall. Now, nobody knew that these paintings were there because they were covered up by plaster. And they weren't rediscovered until about the year 1900, the late 1800s. And they were all uncovered, and they were found to be these Templar paintings depicting scenes about the Ark of the Covenant and everything connected with it. So I thought, well, hold on a minute, this must be clues as to where they know they're dying of the Black Death. Every village the Black Death is, no one comes out alive. Mm-hmm. They're being chased by the king. He's after the money. They're probably going to die of the Black Death. If they're going to hide what they really believe is the most precious item from the Old Testament, they're going to leave clues as to where it is. Could these murals on the wall be it? Well, unfortunately, over the years since it was found, they've crumbled away badly, so you can hardly make out anything of them. But in around about 1900, a local archaeologist, an amateur historian, a man by the name of Jacob Cove Jones, who came from that area near Stratford-upon-Avon, when the murals were still fairly pristine, when they'd only just been uncovered, claimed he'd managed to decipher them and knew where they led. He told other archaeologists and historians who didn't believe him. He knew that he had a condition from which he was dying and he hadn't got long to live. So he decided not to tell anybody where the Ark was hidden. But instead, what he decided to do was to leave his own set of clues that would survive as to where he believed the Ark was hidden. He never dug it up. He left it there because all the murals in the Templar church were falling apart. There's hardly anything left now. He knew this would happen. So he left his own series of clues in a stained glass window that he had. A church was being built near his village, a little tiny little chapel. He paid to have it built and he paid to have a window installed it, and he got a stained glass window glass maker that he knew was a friend of his to design and make this window to specific instructions, which he told people, this is where the clues as to where the Ark is hidden. Well, of course, nobody believed him. And it stayed like that until I came along in about the year 2000 and decided I'd try and sort of solve these clues. I got in touch with one of his descendants, his great-great-granddaughter, who said, yeah, people have tried to solve the clues in the window to find out where he thought that the Ark was hidden, but no one's ever managed to do it. And cutting a long story short, I could explain the whole thing, but it's best if you just look on my website, and if you look at go to the link, which is the Templars and the Ark of the Covenant, you will actually be able to see the stained glass window and how I managed to solve the clues. But basically, the stained glass window in the clues told you that you had to look at two stars, which are the tail stars of the Big Dipper, or the Plough, as we call it in England, as they appear on the 12th night of Christmas, Epiphany night, over the horizon from a tower which has got a strange conical shaped roof that the Knights Templars built on top of these hills near their chapel. And if you go there at 12 o'clock on the 12th of January, and providing that it's cloud free, the two tail stars of the Big Dipper point down just above the horizon to the place you've got to go. So, cutting a long story short, you could probably cheat now by using one of those things they have, those apps for a cell phone. But anyway, then we had to, I didn't have one of those. So we actually discovered that the point, what it pointed down to, was a little village called Chapel Green. And in this village, below the stars that are depicted in this window, stained glass window, is a little red brick arch. And when we got to Chapel Green, in beside the road, in amongst the grass and the brambles, was this little red brick arch. And it turned out to be an old drinking fountain, an old holy well, which had stood right next to a church, which had still been a ruin until the 1950s. And this, it seems, was where Jacob Coe-Jones's clues were leading us to where he believed the Templars had eventually hidden the Ark of the Covenant. Now, I managed to organise archaeologists to go there with a ground penetrating radar to see if there was a chapel or anything gold around this little arch, this holy well. The farmer was on board and said, if you find anything, you can dig. Unfortunately, there was nothing behind the arch. It seemed eventually that what had happened was that the chapel remains, of which I managed to find a couple of old photographs, had stood where the road now is. Mm-hmm. And it had just basically, when the actual road was built in the 1950s, the bricks that made, the stones that made up the chapel, there was no preservation order on things in those days. They were just dumped nearby. And in fact, used by a local farmer to divert a stream. So we went to that area to try and find if we could find the stones from the original chapel. We did a metal detecting thing about throughout the whole area. There was nothing there of gold under the road. We went to where the stones were thrown into this to divert this little stream, and found the stones there from the original church. You could see they were all carved, and basically the church had been taken apart, what was left of its foundations, and just thrown against the bank of this river. And in amongst these stones, the only thing we found of real interest was an inscribed stone. There was nothing gold there. We did metal detectors, the whole lot. There was a stone which was about, 2 feet wide and about 3 feet high with an inscription on it. Now, at first, we thought maybe this was a grave marker or something that had been on the wall of the chapel. But cutting a very long story short, eventually the writing was identified by experts as an early form of Hebrew called Proto-Sinaitic script that was only in use by the ancient Israelites around 13 to 1350 BC, the exact period Moses is said to have lived. The stone it's made from was checked out by experts, scientifically tested, and found to come from the region of Jordan, Petra, where I believe Mount Sinai was, and which is where the Templars claim to have found this ark. So is it possible that what we found? I think that what happened is in the 1950s, when the workmen were digging up the road, I believe they found this art thing. It's a golden thing. They're not going to tell anybody about it. Mm-hmm. What they open it up, they find a couple of stone tablets inside, which is actually the most holy of the artifacts, the stone tablets of the Ten Commandments, and just bung them away, throw them away, chuck them in the river, or smash them up. And I think what we have is half of one of these. The Proto-Sinaitic script has never been properly translated. All that experts are able to tell us from the Hebrew University in Jerusalem is it talks about the ancient Hebrew word for God and something to do with mankind. It doesn't. That's all we know. Now, could the Templars have faked this? The answer really is no, because if they were going to fake a Ten Commandment tablet, they'd write it in Hebrew as it was known at the time. In the Middle Ages, Proto-Sinaitic script was not rediscovered until the 1980s. So nobody would have known to have faked it like that. We might have found half of a Ten Commandment tablet. Awesome. We don't know. Where the rest are, we don't know. But I am still searching for the Ark. And after Christmas, I have a friend from Canada coming over who comes from London, Ontario, and she's going to, she's got a lot of research that she's been doing, and she's going to try and help me find it. I've been looking for it myself, and a friend from America, Jody, have been searching for this thing for years. So there's a new lead. So hopefully, so with the stone tablet you talked, you spoke about, is now in America being examined at a university there, and it could be of the right age and of the right time and in the right language to have been one of the Ten Commandments, but we don't know yet.
But I hope it is. I really do. That's so exciting. I'm really happy to hear that you're making important discoveries. It's just so exciting.
People do ask me, they'll say, one of the biggest questions I've asked is, well, how come you keep finding these things? And I think I'd better explain. There's like three answers to it. The first one, if you asked a police detective, how come you keep solving crimes? Nobody else does. Well, that's what he does. I spend all my time doing this. That's one answer. The second thing, and this is the real serious one, is that people who investigate ancient mysteries of any kind of type, old mysteries, are going to be historians who read manuscripts, archaeologists who dig things up, and scientists who investigate age of objects and so on and so forth. And you get literary people and mythologists, people who actually investigate mythology, folklorists. They don't talk to each other. They can't stand each other. They don't share information. It's happening more now on the net. You can get it, but they don't like each other. They don't share information. And so a lot of the clues that I'm putting together already exist out there to be found. And it's far easier now with the internet to find, as long as you know what you're looking for. Oh, so those archaeologists thought that, and that historian thought that. Oh, and there's the folklore there that tells us this. Wait a minute. So it's like putting together a jigsaw puzzle. And that's really the way that I can manage to do things, because I'm not attached to any university specifically. I've studied as I'm pretty much self-taught in all these disciplines. But what I do is, if I need an archaeologist, I become friendly with an archaeologist. I get them on board. I confuse them. And the same with an historian, the same with a folklorist. And I get them to work together. And in that way, I manage to solve a lot of things that haven't been solved before. And probably the third reason is that some of these things haven't been solved. Academics don't like to touch things like, oh, I'm not going to get involved in a research for Arthur. That's crazy. Everyone thinks that Arthur was some kind of floaty man. I'm not going to look for the Holy Grail. It didn't exist. Just because the Grail may or not have had powers, or that Arthur may or may not have sort of rescued damsels in distress, is not reason to not look into how these legends began in the first place.
Mm-hmm. Right. I'm so happy that you are keeping an open mind, because like mainstream historians and archaeologists don't like to look at they just like to keep a closed mind, but keeping an open mind is always important, right? And that's why in the school system example, they always teach you the same old story, but we have to look for an alternative story too, because maybe there's something missing from our history that we want to know about, right? And it's always good to keep that in mind, right? And to always keep that.
Well, I always say it's like, with William Shakespeare, they'll say William Shakespeare has become sort of like a kind of almost like the patron saint of England. And the story that is told about him, kind of created in Victorian times, he was this nice family man, went to church, loved his wife, supported the government, did everything nicely, and he came up with these amazing ideas. Well, that's kind of, if you want to come up with amazing ideas, you toe the line and be a good little child. If they actually taught that he was a drunken, drug addict, drinking, womanizing, whatever, which is what, strangely, most geniuses in history have happened to be, he wouldn't be the patron saint of England anymore. In fact, it's strange that they say he's born and died on the 23rd of April, which is also St. George's Day, the patron saint of England. I don't know what day Canada Day is. Is there such a thing?
Yes, there is. It's July 1st, Canada Day.
Oh, well, imagine that you had some famous person in Canada, one of your famous people, I'm afraid I'm not very good on Canadian history, but there's obviously somebody very famous that did something. If they were said to have nothing to do about them, were said to have been born and died on Canada Day, you'd be a bit suspicious, wouldn't you? Everyone's a bit suspicious about some of the information that's told about William Shakespeare.
Of course, and yep, exactly. Your work is so incredible, I have to say. Your finds are amazing, and I really, really, I'm just amazed. And could you please give us your info and like your website and Facebook, Twitter, and where people will be able to purchase your books?
Okay, this is the best way to find out everything about me. If you just go into Google and type Graham Phillips author, then everything of me comes up in the first couple of pages. If you just type Graham Phillips into Google, there's another Graham Phillips who's an actor who's Ben 10.
Yeah.
Like a kid's thing. And so he comes up first. There's a few things, and then you'll see me. But if you type in Graham Phillips author, you'll find all my stuff. My website, again, is grahamphillips.net. Me with a net over me. Graham. Ham that's gone grey because it's gone bad, like meat. Graham. Phillips. Fill, like you fill something up. Lips, no. Grahamphillips.net. Right. Ham. If you go on there, everything, the link to my Facebook, which anybody is welcome to join, is there. The link to my Twitter. Everything else can be found there. And I'm on my Facebook, on my website, the news page is a bit old at the moment. I haven't changed it for a bit. But everything I'm going to be doing is going to be on that news page. And the book, once it's published, you'll be able to click on there and order it directly from there. But if you want to place pre-orders, my publisher is called Inner Traditions, and they're based in Vermont. You just type in Inner Traditions, and then Graham Phillips, all my page of their books that they published of mine will be there, and you'll see the King Arthur, the Search for the Tomb of King Arthur is published in April, I think April the 18th or something like that, next year. So I'm not doing any publicity on it yet. That's why I haven't said too much about it. If I told you now, I'll come on your show again and tell you all about it when it comes out.
But if
I told you now, the news would break and all the media would be onto it, and I wouldn't get any publicity when the book came out.
Right. But I'd love to have you back onto my show. Thank you so much for coming on to Crystal Kids TV. It's a pleasure and an honor having you.
It's an honor to have been on it. Thank you very much indeed.
Yeah, it was impossible to talk about all my favorite topics because you got into so many topics, and it's just quite funny that you write about all the topics I love, but it's okay. We could do that next time, but that's why I'm going to have you back very, very soon to learn about the true history of the world, because it's not being taught in the school system, and we need to keep an open mind. And yeah, so I would like to thank you for making some time, and thank you. Maybe we could talk about your upcoming book, like when it gets published.
Yeah, absolutely. There's that publication date. That would be perfect. It would be an honor to be on your show again.
Thank you. Thank you for listening to Crystal Kids TV. I would like to thank the Conscious Consumer Network for allowing me to broadcast on the network. Please support me on my Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and other social medias. You can also check out my website, www.crystalkidsradio.com, for past archives. Please stay tuned for more in the upcoming future. See you next week at the same time, same place. Love, peace, and harmony. Love you.